inspired you to start this center for kinder children?
Yeah, I'm Elizabeth Wedera, but most people call me Lizette, and I'm the founder of Mathare Center for Hindered People. And the reason as to why I started this center is because I had a sister who had some mental challenges, and while she was growing up, I could see the challenges my mom was facing, the stigma and all the talks that were going around my neighborhood. They were not very kind words. So that was something that stuck in my head, and I knew that one day I will start something to do with the people with disability. So I got a chance to travel to Norway, and when I went to Norway, I was working with people with disability, and I just liked the way they worked with these people, the way they treated them, and I just saw that they're just like any other person, and when given that opportunity, they have talents as well. So I decided, when I came back, I decided to open a center.
Can you just give a brief picture of what does it entail to have a hindered child?
Most of the people believe that when you have a kid with disability, you are bewitched, or anything to do with a curse. So you find that these words that are coming from the neighbors and all that stuff, they make you feel so bad, depressed. One, again, also this kid needs special diets. These are things, and especially when you're born in Mathare or any other slum, you cannot be able to afford. And then we have something like physiotherapy. Physiotherapy is expensive to most of the parents, and also availability of the services. You carrying that kid with your back, with public means, taking the kid to the clinics and maybe for the physiotherapies, it is a challenge. Again, we don't have a lot of schools that can be able to accommodate people with disability in Mathare. We only have one that I know, the government one, that is Mathare Special. And maybe for those who don't afford the small fee that they charge, they cannot be able to take the kids to that school. So these are kind of the challenges. And again, most of the kids are using diapers. So when you're taking your kid to school, they need to have the diapers on. So will you buy food or will you buy the diapers? So you find this is something that is affecting most of the parents. And so they decide, because the kid needs to have diapers, then they should stay at home, because at home they don't have to have diapers on. And again, for the daycare centers, there is no any other person willing to babysit a kid that has a disability, because they get convulsions any other time. So when the convulsions attack them, for example, what will you do as a caregiver who is not even well conversant with such things?
Alikaa kwa nyumba karibu ta miaka 4 kwa nyumba kama atumtoi.
Sasa nini ilikuwa inafanya mnafungia mtoto kwa nyumba?
Kwa ajili tunaona akai kama wale wengine, yeye aongei, hatembei, haitisi kitu yoyote, ananyamaza tu. Sasa hiyo ndio tu tulikuwa tunaona, hata tukimtoa nje kwa wale watoto wengine, tunao watoto wengine wanacheza na yeye achezi. Sasa yeye anakaa tu.
When we were trying to set up this place, we did something like a conference or something where we called all the parents that we knew through the networks that we had. We knew that they had kids with disability, so they came without the kids, but they could not even trust us that much that they can leave us with the kids, and they would make comments like, hey, ni nani atakuangalilia mtoto, nani atakutolea mtoto mavi, and all that stuff. But we had already planned ourselves through the experience that I had in Norway, and I knew that we had employed people that can be able to take care of that such kind of things. So when we were trying to bring in the parents, they didn't even show up, because they didn't trust us. And some of the kids were brought even with some things tied on the waists, because the parents believed that the kids were bewitched. So we tried our level best by educating the parents and making them understand that it is not all about caste, it is a condition that has been there. So it was a lot of work to try and remove that mentality in them.
Tukapatana na Lisi. Lisi akasema atakuweka daycare ya watoto disabled. Hapo tulisaidika. Kwa ajili hata mtu anakuja analeta mtoto yake hapa na uenda kusugulika ndio huyo mtoto apate maziwa na upate pesa ya dawa.
What are the qualifications that one must have for you to start a center for the hindered people?
You need to have a big heart because this you have to remove diapers for kids that you don't even know that you started working with. You need to feed these kids, you need to have them during the day and maybe try to engage them in different activities. So if you don't have a big heart, this is something that you can't do, you know. So you don't have to have any qualification for you to start such a thing, but the pain that maybe you went through or the experience that you've had before with people with disability, this just fuels that energy that you need to apply when you're starting such a thing.
Coming from a less privileged community like Mathare and being as young as you are, I know when you introduced this kind of a center, there must be so many challenges that you experience. What are the kind of unique experience that you got from parents?
I remember when we were starting, most of the parents would say like most of the people have started such centers so that they can use our kids to get resources, because you know, like I didn't talk about my sister then, and then they've never seen someone who is so passionate with people with disability, so they could see like, hey, Liz wants to use our kids maybe to get funds and all that stuff. But later on they came to realize that this is so different, because then we had not started having like friends of the center, because we don't have donors, we have friends of the center, the ones who are helping us. So before then I would use my own money and maybe to buy diapers, maybe to buy food and feed them. So they came on learning these things that are happening and said, hey, there is something different with this one. So it was a challenge when I introduced my sister, and they were very shocked to see like I have, my sister is 30 year old, so this is a big person, and having grown taking care of her when my mom died, it has been a challenge also for my grandmother to be able to raise a youth with disability in putting in mind that we come from a very hostile environment. So she doesn't have a kid at her age, she has never been abused, so this is something that's so encouraging. And this, through the parents, I use her as well as a person that they can be able to learn or be motivated when they see her. So through her and all that stuff and the things that I have been doing, they have gained confidence with me that we are not using them to get any funds. And we've employed some of the parents, they work with the kids, because we have people that clean this place, we have people that feed these kids, we have people that are also changing them diapers. So we need to have maybe people that have kids with disability to work with them, so that they can understand each other and be able to feed the kids or change the kids without anything in the heart.
What are the unique things that you picked from the other side that you realize they are not being applied here in Kenya?
Most of the people, and especially the ones with severe mental challenges, are not given that opportunity here in Kenya. And again, we're also trying to give them that opportunity to read and to write and to sing and all that stuff. But you find like mostly in other places, they think that these kids are very severe, they can't do anything. Because like in Norway, you could find like a person doesn't talk, doesn't respond, doesn't do anything, but they're given that opportunity to do something. They can be able to do something even without talking or doing any other thing that we think that a normal person can be able to do. So us giving them that opportunity where they can be able to do things, you just feel like it's a plus. And we can see changes, and we can see the milestone they are having after introducing these small activities. Because as you can see, we have a big place where they can be able to play. Even the ones that can not be able to sit down, you just give them that opportunity to do something. And again, I learned like they get employed. like the ones living in Norway, for example, I'm using that example because I've worked with them. You find them, even the ones with the severe disability, they are put in one room and then they can maybe pick a screw and put it inside a paper, maybe pack, and then they're taken to these like different companies where they're working with different things like the sockets and all that stuff. So you find like they come to work every day and they are paid, and this is someone that cannot even move, but even shaking and picking something, even if it's two screws the whole day, that is an achievement for these people. We want to make this place like a place where even the ones who are severe can be able to work and get their salary is by doing small things. Maybe we can talk to companies where they need to assemble all these things and put them together, so we talk to them so that we can be doing that through the people with disability, and then they are paid something small. So we also had like the ones who are blind, they're the ones who are venturing into music, they want to record the song, they are songwriters as well. So there are different things that they can be able to do when given that opportunity, but the most outstanding one is maybe trying to get companies that can work with us by employing these people.
What kind of services do you guys offer to such a group?
We have like the free physiotherapy that we offer for the kids, and we also offer a balanced diet for them because, as you know, their bones are still weak and they need a lot of food that has calcium and all that stuff. And we also offer free diapers for the kids as well. And for the parents, what we've done, we have sewing machines with us. So for those who want to learn how to make to tailor clothes and all that stuff, they have that opportunity, and we've paid someone who can be able to teach them. And again, we give them weekends because these kids, they also need the other siblings so they can be able to mingle and have friends, and also mingle with the parents or bond with the parents and the other siblings. So that's why we don't work on Saturdays and Sundays. So for the serious cases where we see that they cannot afford medicines, we also offer the medicines, but we are not actually there where we can be able to provide medicine for everyone because these medicines are very expensive, and as I said, we don't have donors to fund us so that we can be able to provide medicines for them. So you find myself even going deep in my pockets and buying some medicine for other people because it is not in our budget.
What are the notable challenges that you are facing?
We had stopped with the physiotherapy services for quite some time because of the government directives. So our kids stopped, the ones who are working, they stopped working again because they couldn't get these services again. And I felt so bad, and that's why we were able to bring back the services again, the physiotherapy services. Again, we don't have like, for example, today we went for a burial of one of the kids. They're dying because the medicine, you find that the flow, the medicines are out of stock. So the you find like the ones they've been using because of convulsions are being changed to these other medicines, and because the body is used to this one medicine, then you find like yes, and then what next? The convulsions continues and then they die.
Kuna zile madawa wanakunywanga, hizo dawa ni shida kupata na siko na bei kali. Sasa unaona ukipata pesa kidogo na unashindwa ni dawa utanunua au ni chakula.
Most of the parents also cannot afford these medicines, so they are struggling to get the medicine. So in between struggling, taking the kids also to clinics, because all the time they're in and out of hospital. So it is an expensive condition. It's a very expensive condition. So to maintain it, you find some parents not having enough resources, so the kid ends up dying.
Are there successful stories?
We had a lot of kids that were brought in without even walking, but coming into a center and having the sessions and maybe the food and all that stuff, they start walking, even if it is not like fully, but you can see like they can stand on their own and make few steps. So I just believe that if given more time, we can have a lot of successful stories.
Kama wetu alikuwa ataongei hata kidogo, siku hizi anaitana baba. Alikuwa ashiki kitu, siku hizi anashikaga kitu. Shingo ilikuwa ishiki, shingo yake tulikuwa inaguka tu. Lakini kutoka anze therapy, shingo ilisimama. Siku hizi hata ukimsimamisha kidogo anasimama, lakini anaanguka. Sasa lazima umshikirie.
What kind of appeal can you give out there to the public, the government?
I would say like the government can look into such organizations that are working with these people directly and maybe boost these services that are being offered at the centers.